just out of curiosity, of the people in the audience, who actually met Hugh Daniel? Like everyone? Half of them?
Cool.
So we might be telling you war stories that you've already heard, or if you have your own war stories, then we have a mic and we would love to hear them and save them for posterity. So please do come up and speak to the mic and share with your stories. This is not so much us speaking, but it's all an interaction of all of us. This is, you know, for the people who weren't there when he died in San Francisco, and they had a memorial there, and we didn't really have one. At least I didn't have one. So I'd like to share lots of stories. And he's a good guy. I met him, so I'll tell the story while John is still working on how I met him. Some people might remember a trip to Solips. Vesna and other people know. And the story is, our group of people had a sort of a pre-hacker space called the Hangout in Amsterdam, and we had a car with that group of people. And so we had two groups of people driving with a car. So basically, I owned a car and a half going to Solip. So by the time I got there, the other group of people who drove, I will not mention names, trashed the car so much that it couldn't drive anymore, and it was stuck on the camping area, basically not being able to drive. So me, having absolutely no skills whatsoever in fixing cars in the middle of nowhere, sort of asked around my friends, and quickly everybody told me, you should find this big, loud American, he can fix anything. So I ended up finding Hugh, and he came to me, he walked up to the car, I told him what was wrong, he looked under the car, he wriggled something under the car, and then he told me, okay, now you should really drive very, very slowly to a mechanic, and these are the parts you have to replace. And the next day, that's exactly what we did. And so, I think my mic cut out there. And so that's how I first met him. And then, of course, you know, walking around and talking while waiting for things and car mechanics, we started talking. And he's like, so, Paul, what do you do? Well, I have this tiny ISP in Holland, and you know, I'm playing around with little Linux boxes on floppy disks. You know, one LRP for those people who know the Linux router project, or a Linux router on a single floppy disk. And he basically told me, you know, if you're having a 24 connection, because at the time that was pretty rare, like having a dial-up or like a leased line. Like I had a leased line 14K4 modem to my house, and nobody had 24-hour connections at the time. When we started talking about that, he's like, you know, you should encrypt that. It's like, okay. So he said, yeah, I do this Freesound project, and you know, you should look at replacing it or adding it to your machine and doing that. So we ended up talking about it. It's like, yeah, well, crypto couldn't hurt, I guess. I didn't really see much use of it at the time, but I started doing that, and I'm not sure how much time was between that and the next round of IETFs and other conferences in Strasbourg and other places. But basically, Hugh and me ended up touring Europe for 3 months, going to various conferences, doing Freesound work, and telling people how to do opportunistic encryption and how to encrypt the internet. And, you know, with the goal that, you know, John Gilmore and Hugh Daniel started up with trying to encrypt the internet. What was it again, John? 10% per year?
Start with 1%.
1%. So unfortunately, we didn't make it. I think we're going to have a few slides, like two slides, with the idea that we had then, kind of explain why it failed, and actually the new idea that I had, that I'd actually been talking regularly with Hugh Daniel with. Of course, the problem with Hugh Daniel, talking to Hugh Daniel,